click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, welcome back to Electromagnetic Field Theory. Up till now in this chapter number 5, Conductors and Dielectrics, we have gone through the concepts of what is exactly the current. The current density is K bar and J bar for the sheet of conductive material and the conductive material which is practically having certain volume. We have seen the relations of these current densities with the charge densities, rho s, that is surface charge density measured in coulomb per meter square, and rho v, that is the volume charge density measured in coulomb per meter cube. Based on to this concept, we have solved certain problems also. Later on, we have seen the current continuity equation, which is a very significant equation when we will be switching from time invariant fields to time varying fields. After that, we have this topic, the conductors, properties and the boundary conditions, where exactly we are going to see how the conductive materials behave to the electric field produced because of certain source charge. What are the properties exhibited by those conductive materials when the electric field is present? We will be deriving certain boundary conditions, the boundary which separates one medium to another medium. So here in this video, we are going to take the perfect conductive material with the free space, which is the perfect dielectric medium. So at the boundary separation between free space and the perfect conductor, how exactly the electric field behaves, electric field in terms of electric field intensity and electric flux density specifically. So those relationships we will be deriving. So let us begin with the topic, conductors, properties and boundary conditions. So the first term to this title is conductors. Whenever we call the term conductors, we come to know the classification with conductors and non-conductors, which we also call as insulators and sometimes dielectric materials also. The better classification of conductors, dielectric materials and moreover semiconductors is done with the help of energy band diagram. Energy band diagram gives us the details of energy levels of conduction band and the valence band, what we have seen at the atomic studies, atomic level physics subject. So thereupon, if there is energy band gap, so that band gap we call forbidden energy gap, band gap, the electron, the free electron has to be there for conduction purpose. So the electron has to be switching from valence band to the conduction band. So in the conductors, basically a lot of or large number of free electrons may be available if we apply certain electric field across that particular material. But that is not the condition with respect to the insulators. The forbidden energy gap, the energy band gap between the conduction band and the valence band is very much high, so that the electrons cannot get out of that atomic structure and get acted as like charge carrier. So this makes the difference between the insulators, which we call dielectrics, and the conductors. In semiconductors, for example, silicon and germanium, that energy band gap is short with respect to the dielectrics, where on application of certain electric field, the electron can pass from valence band to conduction band. So for conductors, we can make the points. The first one, large number of free electrons. Large number of free electrons. Now, if a conductive material is here and we apply electric field to both the ends of this particular material, so that time whatever the free electrons, or let us say the charge carriers, will be there in the body of this particular material, they will be having a directional flow. So that directional flow, definitely the charge carriers will have the velocity. So for that particular velocity, we say the velocity is a drift velocity denoted by V suffix D. Because on application of electric field only, the charge carriers are getting drifted from one end to another end. Okay, so that is why the drift velocity here we can give in terms of minus mu suffix E capital E bar. As the velocity is there, we put the unit meter per second. Now capital E bar is the applied electric field here, and mu e is called as mobility of free electrons. as this is the mobility of free electrons. In the conductors, I have put the suffix E here to the mu. Generally, we represent mu only, and minus sign because the electrons having the negative polarity, hence on application of electric field, they get to the reverse direction of that electric field. So Vd, drift velocity, Vd is given as drift velocity given by this relation. Now in the last topics we have seen the relationship between the current density and the charge density, and for conduction current J bar, conduction current density J bar, we have the relation J bar is equal to rho V into V. So V here is also the velocity, whereas rho V is the volume charge density given in terms of coulomb per meter cube. This is in ampere per meter square and this is in meter per second. Now in the place of this particular V, if we put drift velocity, what could be the relation of J bar for the drift velocity? So in terms of drift velocity, J bar will be equal to minus mu suffix E, as the electrons are the charge carriers. So I put rho V suffix E to be the electron charge density with respect to the volume multiplied by capital E bar, that is electric field. So this will be in ampere per meter square. Now for current density J bar, we know another relation. J bar is equal to sigma times E bar, where E bar is the electric field intensity, applied electric field we can say. Sigma is the conductivity of the medium and J bar is the current density. This relation is sometimes also called as the Ohm's law. Generally in circuit theory, network analysis, Ohm's law we write V is equal to IR, where the relationship between the voltage and the current with the constant, that is resistance value we have found, is given to us. So here J bar is a part from this current. So it is current density. E bar, for E bar we have the unit, that is volts per meter. So it is from this V. Okay. So the relationship between the voltage and the current can also be written in this form. J bar is equal to sigma times E bar. So resistance is opposition to the flow of current, whereas conductivity sigma is how permissible the medium is to the flow of electricity. So the resistance value and the conductivity value, they are inversely proportional to each other. Sigma represents the conductivity here. So we have two relations of J bar. J bar is equal to minus mu E rho V times E bar, and J bar is equal to sigma E bar. So for these two equations, we can equate the right hand sides and we shall get the form, that is sigma E bar is equal to minus mu E rho V E E bar. So E bar we can take out from both the sides. Finally, we obtain sigma is equal to minus mu suffix E rho V E, as this is conductivity. The conductivity is always measured in terms of mho per meter. So for the term conductors, we have derived the formula for conductivity. Conductivity always be written represented by this sigma, and it is the minus mobility of electron into the volume charge density. If the charge carrier is positive, that time we have to take positive magnitude. So we have discussed what exactly the conductors are. The next term in this title is properties. So here we are going to discuss more specifically the properties of a perfect conductor. Okay. So initially, what is perfect conductor? Just now we have seen sigma representing the conductivity in mho per meter, that means mho per unit length. So perfect conductor is having sigma to be equal to infinity. So the conductive material which have conductivity value very much high, approaching infinity, is called as perfect conductor. Practically there is no perfect conductor because it has certain limitations, the conductivity has certain limitations. Hence, but still we see the perfect conductor. So for perfect conductor, sigma is equal to infinity. Now at the surface of a perfect conductor, if somehow certain charge is there, so that charge on the surface of perfect conductor move tangentially till the tangential force becomes equal to zero and get neutralized. Okay. Hence, because of this, under steady conditions, the charges gets distributed uniformly onto the surface of a perfect conductor. The charges does not lie inside the body of the conductive material, but get uniformly distributed onto the surface of a perfect conductor. As they get distributed onto the surface, hence the term rho s, that is surface charge density, in terms of coulomb per meter square we have to use. Hence, there is no free charge inside the body of the perfect conductor. So, because there is no free charge, so there will not be any kind of field representing E bar or D bar. So, for a perfect conductor, the E bar will be equal to 0, D bar will also be equal to 0. The no free charge can move, can be there in the body of perfect conductor. Hence, Q will also be equal to 0. The charge, if present anyhow, so that charge will be on the surface of the perfect conductor and having the uniform density, that is rho s, surface charge density. Now later on we move to the third term of this particular title, that is boundary conditions. So for deriving the boundary conditions, we initially assume such a line which separates medium 1 from medium 2. So here I mention medium 1 and this is medium 2. So let the medium 2 is a perfect conductor. Hence we take some mobility of the charge carriers mu 2. Epsilon 2 for medium 2 will be equal to epsilon 0 and sigma 2 for medium 2 will be equal to infinity. Medium 1 let us consider to be the free space. So for free space, for medium 1 suffix 1 I put, it will be mu 0, then epsilon 1 will be epsilon 0 and sigma 1 will be equal to 0. Because free space is a perfect dielectric, there cannot be any kind of conductivity by charge carriers into the free space. So this line separates medium 1, which is free space, from medium 2, which is perfect conductor. Hence this line I call the boundary separating medium 1 to medium 2. Now when the electric field goes from medium 1 to medium 2 or medium 2 to medium 1, what happens at exact boundary separation, that we have to see. So the components of capital E bar and capital D bar representing electric field intensity and electric flux density, we can resolve into two types. To this boundary, the component may be a normal component, that means perpendicular to it, and the tangential component. So here I represent the normal component from medium 2 by dn2 and en2, whereas the tangential components will be like this. So I shall be having the representation dt2 and et2, and in medium 1 we shall be representing dn1, en1, and the tangential component to the boundary by dt suffix 1 and et suffix 1, or we can say d tan, e tan, okay, d norm, e norm. So these are the components in medium 2 and in medium 1, tangential as well as normal. I can show the normal direction at any point that is perpendicular to this boundary by the unit vector a and cap. So now to get the tangential component behavior at the boundary separating medium 1 and medium 2, that are free space and perfect conductor, let us take the help from the relation, that is closed line integral E bar dot of dl bar is equal to 0. Because if the fields are static fields, here we have closed line integral. So we will be going back to the same point here. The electric field intensity at the point will be the same, hence the difference will be equal to 0. So for this is holding true as for static field. Now for applying this relation to the exact boundary, here we consider an incremental path at the boundary surface which is having half portion in the medium 1 and half portion in the medium 2. So here we put the directions. So directions are given. Now along this line, the tangential component of electric field intensity we have to see, this is ET2. Whereas the tangential component in medium 1 will be ET1 directed this way. So here we have the direction of this loop along the direction of ET1, but in case of medium 2, the direction of the loop and the direction of ET2 are reverse direction. Now to this particular loop, if we talk about the dimension, let us represent the width by delta W. So delta W is the width and delta H will be the height for this particular loop. So delta H upon 2 lies into the medium 1 and delta H upon 2 again lies into the medium 2. Now using the dimensions of delta W and delta H at the incremental loop at the boundary, we can have the representation of this relation closed line integral E bar dot of dl bar is equal to 0 in this form. Let us represent ET1 delta W minus EN1 delta H upon 2 minus EN2 delta H upon 2 minus ET2 delta W plus EN2 delta H upon 2 plus EN1 delta H upon 2. This is all equal to 0. Here the plus sign occurs when the direction of both the component and the loop are same. Whereas if there is a reverse direction combination for the loop and the vector component, so that time we will be putting the negative sign here. So this is the complete left hand side, that is closed line integral E bar dot of dl bar, and RHS is same, that is equal to 0. So here to get the relation exactly at the boundary, so it means the incremental closed loop, we have consider half portion into the medium 1, half portion into the medium 2, that is delta H by 2 dimensions in medium 1 and medium 2. We have to get the relation exactly at the boundary. So to get it exactly at the boundary, we will be applying delta H tends to equal to 0, so that from both the medium 1 and medium 2, we will get exactly at the boundary. So applying delta H tends to 0 to the above equation, we get the form, that is ET1 delta W minus ET2 delta W again will be equal to 0. So delta W can be common, and finally we can write ET1 is equal to ET2. So this is the relation where we can say the tangential component of electric field intensity in medium 1 is equal to tangential component of electric field intensity in medium 2. But as we have just now seen the properties of a perfect conductor, because one of our medium is a perfect conductor, and inside the perfect conductor there cannot be any electric field intensity, there cannot be any charge actually. Hence, no electric field intensity, no electric flux density. Hence, we have to make ET2 equal to 0. So, we get the relation ET1 is equal to 0. So, this is the boundary condition for tangential component of electric field intensity for the boundary separating free space from the perfect conductor. Now, we have the relation D bar is equal to epsilon into E bar. So here we can write the relation as ET1 is equal to 0, using that particular relation, we can write DT1 is equal to also 0. Hence here, the tangential components of the electric field, that is electric field intensity and electric flux density, does not exist at the boundary separating the perfect dielectric, that is free space, from the perfect conducting medium. So these are the boundary conditions for the tangential components of electric field. Now let us start to have the boundary conditions for normal components of electric field. So for normal components of electric field, we will be considering an incremental closed surface along the boundary. So let us represent again, this is the boundary separating the perfect conducting medium on this side and the free space, that is perfect dielectric medium, on this side. So here again we have the representations of dN2, EN2, that are the normal components, dT2, ET2 we have already worked with. In medium 1 there will be dN1, EN1, the normal components of electric flux density and electric field intensity, and dT1, ET1. So here we consider incremental closed surface, a pillbox shaped this diagram. So this diagram also holds half portion into the medium 1, half portion into the medium 2. If delta H is the entire height of this object, so here we have delta H upon 2, delta H upon 2 in both the medium. Now this object has three surfaces, top, bottom and the cylindrical surface. So for the top, the normal direction will be outward and it will be dN1, and the delta S bar, differential surface for the top. Similarly, the differential surface for the bottom will be outward like this inside the medium 2. This will be the direction of dN2 for this closed surface. Here it was here, and AN cap, we are representing the unit vector along the normal to this boundary separating medium 1 to medium 2. So this is medium 1 and medium 2. So for this closed surface, we have delta S to be the top and bottom, and delta H to be the height. From the cylindrical surface, we assume the flux is emerging out from all the sides, that we can denote by delta psi, psi representing the electric flux. Now to this boundary, to have the relation of normal components, we will be applying the Gauss's law relation. That Gauss's law relation in integral form, we have closed surface integral d bar dot of ds bar is equal to volume integral rho v dv. Whatever the total amount of flux is leaving from that incremental closed surface pillbox shape, so that is on the left hand side, and the charge enclosed in that particular closed surface is represented by volume integral rho v dv on right hand side of this equation. So applying this equation from the integral part of Gauss's law to this particular closed surface, we can have the representation in terms of dN1 delta S minus dN2 delta S plus delta psi is equal to rho v delta H delta S. Here the positive signs we have taken when the normal component of the electric flux density and that of the differential surface is same. If they are reversed, we have to take the negative sign. So this is for the top, this is for the bottom, and this is for the cylindrical surface on left hand side. And it is given by rho v, and differential volume is the multiplication of top or bottom differential surface area delta S multiplied by delta H, height of this particular cylinder. Now here also, to get the boundary conditions at exact line separating medium 1 to medium 2, we have to do delta H tends to 0. So when we do so, the above equation above equation will be affected with one more thing, that is limit delta S tends to 0. We have to make rho V delta H is equal to rho S coulomb per meter square. So initially we are having the closed surface. This closed surface has certain volume. So upon delta S tends to 0, the top of this closed surface and bottom of this closed surface will be coinciding each other at the boundary. So it won't be having any kind of volume. It will be having only the cross-sectional or differential surface delta S. Hence we make the changes like this and rewrite the equation. That will be dN1 delta S minus dN2 delta S is equal to rho S delta S. So delta S is common to left hand side and right hand side. So we rewrite it in more simpler form. dN1 minus dN2 is equal to rho S. Now dN1 is the normal component of electric flux density in medium 1. So this is the medium 1, that is free space. And dN2 is the normal component of electric flux density in medium 2, which is perfect conductor. And already we have discussed the properties of perfect conductor, that no charge exists in the body of the perfect conductive material. Hence there is no chance for electric field intensity component or electric flux density component. So here we have to make dN2 is equal to 0. So substituting dN2 equal to 0, we are left with the relation dN1 will be equal to rho S and the unit will be coulomb per meter square. So this is the boundary condition for the normal component of electric flux density. Again, we have the relation d bar is equal to epsilon times E bar. So we shall have the relation in terms of normal component of electric field intensity. Hence we can write En1 to be equal to rho S upon epsilon 1 volts per meter. So as this is for medium 1, we can write this rho S upon epsilon 1. Epsilon 1 is the permittivity of the medium or dielectric constant. You can say dielectric constant generally we take to be the epsilon R, relative dielectric constant. Permittivity of the medium 1. If it is epsilon 2, it is permittivity of the medium 2. So these were the boundary conditions when the boundary is separating the medium 1, that is perfect dielectric free space, from the medium 2, that is perfect conductor, having conductivity sigma equal to 0. With this, we complete this topic. I hope you have enjoyed this video. For more information on to the electromagnetic field theory, please subscribe to Ekeeda channel. In the subsequent lecture, we are supposed to practice certain problems based on to the conductors, properties and boundary conditions, especially what we have seen in this video. Thank you.